there to say, hey, that's enough. You're still a little girl. I don't want you to grow up so fast. But it didn't happen.
In the first days of June, all across the country, there is a powerful sense of anticipation. The Allied invasion of Western Europe is about to begin. Of all the exploits in American military history, this will be the grandest.
Every year, and it's been a lot of years now since 1944, but along about the end of May, I start having nightmares and awakening in the night, perspiring heavily, and I would have terrible, terrible dreams. This went on for years until finally my wife pinpointed it and said, you've got a time clock in your mind, and it relates to World War II and D-Day and your landing on the beach of Normandy.
This is Supreme Headquarters, Allied Expeditionary Force. Under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France.
I was working at Boeing and turned my little radio on, and all of a sudden, I heard them saying, D-Day has begun. And all you could hear were these tremendous bombers roaring. And the girl on our switchboard said, I've got permission from the plant to have you up that radio, and we're going to play it across the field. And that's the way a lot of Boeing people learned that it was D-Day.
Almighty God, our sons, pride of our nation, this day have set upon a mighty endeavor, a struggle to preserve our republic, our religion, and our civilization. Lead them straight and true. Give strength to their arms, stoutness to their hearts, steadfastness in their faith. Their road will be long and hard. Some will never return. Embrace these, Father, and receive them, thy heroic servants, into thy kingdom.
So the doorbell rang, and a very old man delivered the telegram. And on the outside of the telegram were two or three stars, I can't remember. And I saw those stars, and my blood turned cold. I knew immediately that my brother had been killed. And we ripped open the telegram, and I can't remember the wording. It was something that the adjutant general or somebody I'd never heard of, someone I never heard of in my whole life, regrets to tell me that my beloved brother had been killed. It was one of the most horrible moments of my life.
Despite heavy casualties, the nation is buoyant over the successful invasion. Optimism mounts that the war in Europe will be over by Christmas. For 13 million black Americans, the struggle against fascism is having unforeseen consequences here at home. The war against Hitler and his racist policies is forcing the nation to confront its own racism. Under continuing pressure from civil rights groups, the federal government now begins to take strong action against racial discrimination. The most dramatic example occurs in Philadelphia in August 1944. The Philadelphia Transit Company hired blacks as laborers only, with no hope of promotion. After repeated warnings, the President's Committee on Fair Employment ordered the company to promote blacks to driver positions.
At that particular time, it was announced over the news that night that they had accepted eight blacks to be trolley operators. That following morning, I gets up to report to my location. It wasn't any vehicles running in the city. Everybody went on strike. They said they definitely did not want no blacks trolley car and the buses at that particular time.
Rapid fire developments in the Philadelphia transit strike.
There was open defiance of the United States government in Philadelphia tonight. More than 5,000 of the city's transit workers had refused to go back to work. Their leaders say there will be no back to work unless the government gives them a written agreement that Negroes will not be trained and used as operators. And the 8 Negroes are sticking to their guns.
So, there it was until Roosevelt sent the troops in. Once they reported for work, every vehicle that left that garage and had two soldiers on it, one in the front, one in the back, carabine rifles with clips on the belt. And I've had people to get on and I made an attempt to pay their fare and look up and they saw that I was actually a black man. They stepped back, said they don't ride with no niggas. Just like that, I'll have to use the expression, just the same way they said. Said I don't ride with no niggas. That's the biggest reason that I continued, and I figured I would prove to the people that I actually could do the job. And by me doing that, it would make a better opportunity for the blacks to continually being hired.
The American public was forced to experience integration in the workplace. People learned that it was possible for blacks and whites to work together. Today we see that as a fairly ordinary thing. But in those days, it was a revolutionary kind of thing. And it took a certain amount of guts to move into it.
Blacks have entered the mainstream of American industry as never before. They are gaining not only jobs, but valuable skills that will be useful when the war ends. For millions of black Americans, decent work now raises the possibility of a decent standard of living.
When I got my first paycheck, I had never seen that much money. I'd never seen that much money in the bank, because I'd never been in a bank too much. So when I first got my first paycheck, I bought everything that I thought I had ever wanted. But the most thing that attracted me was shoes. And the reason I wanted these shoes, because I had worked for this white lady who had a lot of money in Sapulpa, and she bought beautiful shoes. And I would say to myself, one day I would be able to buy these shoes.
People from all levels of society now have greater income. 3 years of full employment, high wages, and lots of overtime have filled the pockets of the average worker.
When I went into the Navy Yard, I went in as a third-class machinist. Then I worked up to a second class. I worked up to a first-class machinist, and then into progressman. At third-class machinist, making $1 an hour. As I worked up into the progressman, I made $2.75 an hour. Which was seemed like more money than I'd ever heard of.
Despite wartime restrictions, Americans are embarked on a spending spree. After the lean years of the Depression, the luxury of cash to spend at will seems almost miraculous. One Philadelphia jeweler says, people are crazy with money. They don't care what they buy. They purchase things just for the fun of spending. Where consumer goods are not available, Americans are spending their money on entertainment and recreation. Racetrack attendance climbs to the highest levels ever recorded. Americans are also streaming to resort spots like Miami and Virginia Beach. As one reporter notes, Americans are finding fun and lots of it. People are not only spending, but also saving in record amounts. By 1944, Americans had put away $140 billion in savings accounts and bonds. The working class is becoming middle class.
We had $1,000 in silver dollars as a doorstop in our house, where 5 years before we were
completely impoverished. It was quite a trip from one thing to the other.
If the worker has benefited, so has big business. Corporate profits have more than doubled since 1941. As long as the war continues, business has a guaranteed customer in Uncle Sam. But business is also looking forward to the post-war era and the pent-up demands for consumer goods. Even before the war ends, magazine ads are whetting the consumer's appetite.
I thought after the war, it'll be like paradise. Everybody will have jobs, everybody can buy a house, new cars will be made. Even I might buy a new car. New refrigerators will be made, washing machines, and who knows what else, and we'll be able to buy them.
But the war rages on into 1945 and becomes even more costly. In the Battle of the Bulge in Europe, in the space of 1 month, America suffers 55,000 casualties. In the Pacific, the battle for tiny Iwo Jima claims 1,500 American lives the first day. America will suffer more casualties in the last year of the war than during the entire preceding 3 years.
Well, death was all around you, came constantly. You were so afraid when someone would show up with a telegram. And I saw people get telegrams and wouldn't even open them. They knew what was in them. It came in bunches. This was the shocking thing. They came as many as 5 or 6 in a day.
But the war in Europe is almost over. On the Eastern Front, the Russian armies have crossed the German border and are heading for Berlin. From the West, American and British troops are racing through France and will soon cross the Rhine River. With victory in Europe close at hand, Roosevelt, Churchill, and Stalin meet in Yalta in February 1945. As the world eagerly watches, the big three make plans for post-war Europe. But the American commander-in-chief will not live to see the final victory. 2 months later, on April 12th, Franklin Delano Roosevelt dies of a cerebral hemorrhage. The president's death comes as a shock that people will recall for the rest of their lives.
When I heard about President Roosevelt's death, well, I had a handkerchief up to my face, wiping tears from my eye, because I realized he was dead. Because I figured he was one of the greatest presidents we ever had.
But the president's death is only one event in what is perhaps the most cataclysmic year in history. As Allied troops break into German territory, the full extent of Nazi war crimes becomes known. In the long blood-stained history of mankind, there has been nothing to compare with the horrors of places like Auschwitz, Buchenwald, Dachau. Now the war seems more justified than ever. On May 8th, Germany surrenders. The war is over for Europe, but the suffering is not. Much of Europe's population is now homeless and starving. To aid the devastated millions, the United States sends food, medicine, clothing. Some American troops will remain in Europe to aid in the relief effort and to serve as an occupying force. For others, the war is not yet over.
When the combat was over in the European theater, our division was sent back to the United States, and we were all given 30 days convalescent leave. That meant a chance to go home and see our loved ones, and be reunited and have some rest. And then we went back to our assigned station after the 30 days. We were immediately loaded into a train. The train left, and we were then told that we were combat loaded for an invasion of the coast of Japan and that we would debark from Seattle. And I knew that if I went over into combat in Japan, that I would never come back. Now, don't ask me how I knew it, but I just felt there was one with my name on it because I'd been through a lot of combat by this time.
Although facing defeat, Japan refuses to agree to America's terms for unconditional surrender. It is estimated that the invasion of Japan will cost 250,000 American lives.
We traveled for about a half a day, and then the train stopped in the middle of a large prairie, and we stayed there for 3 days and did nothing but play baseball, and it was dull. It was especially dull because we were apprehensive because we knew something was going on. And they allowed us then to listen on a radio, and they had dropped this horrible bomb on Hiroshima and killed thousands and thousands of people, and we were in shock.
When the bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, this boy was in our kitchen, and he said, "Ha, ha, ha, they dropped a bomb on Japan, and all the babies are dead." And that really upset me. I guess the way he said it, you know, I didn't think I had that much feeling for Japan, but that, I really broke down that, hearing that.
The Japanese have accepted our terms fully. That's the word we've just received from the White House in Washington. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the end of the Second World War.
New York and Main Street everywhere pulls out the stops and lets go. Yes, from coast to coast, victory gets a spontaneous welcome.
We bought several dozen condoms and filled them with water and dropped them out the windows on the people below, on the street below. We couldn't find any balloons. It was all we could use. Filled them with water and water bombed everybody.
People started drinking, and to me this simply was not the response that I felt. I felt that I wanted to go to church. And my husband and I went to church and said a prayer of thanksgiving that the killing was over. And then we went back to the hotel and joined the party.
The biggest, noisiest celebration in New York's history.
The news that we received was in about 7 o'clock in the evening. We decided to really have a party. And I stood on a chair with a sheet wrapped around me and a flashlight in my hand. And I was a Statue of Liberty, and all the family danced around me. It was a great celebration.
Of all the hopes and desires that follow victory, the strongest is bring the boys home.
But words can't.
The readjustment to peace will be difficult for many Americans, soldiers and civilian alike. Nearly 600,000 GIs will return wounded or crippled, many with severe psychological problems. For some, the reunion of veteran and wife will be traumatic. In the year following the war, the divorce rate is the highest in American history.
We're so glad to have them home. We didn't want to cause any antagonism, but deep down inside, we were fighting a terrific battle because all of a sudden, everything's taken out of our hands. The checkbook, oh, you don't know how to balance a checkbook. You've been doing it for 4 years.
I feel I am as big a war casualty as anyone who was wounded, maimed, crippled during the war. Had it not been for the war, I would never have married a man I didn't know the first thing about. I wasn't even sure this man knew my middle name after we were married.
For the overwhelming majority of Americans, the war has not meant personal tragedy or loss. The coming of peace is a blessing and a new beginning. What Americans have dreamed about for 4 years, the brave new post-war world, is finally here. The problems that had plagued Americans before the war, the unemployment, the loss of confidence, the lack of opportunity, are gone. Everywhere it seems a new America is in the making. Now the country stands as if on a mountain of power. $26 billion worth of new factories have been built, an enormous increase in industrial capacity. Very soon the nation will reach a level of prosperity and abundance never before experienced in American life. In the words of one journalist, America has inherited the earth.
The war made me really love this country more than ever. During the Depression, you got hate in your country because you were so poor, had nothing. And then come along and this country fought the war, won the war, showed what people could turn out and do. So it made you think you were living in the right country.
But the legacy of World War II was not simply greater wealth or power. The American way of life itself had begun to change. Of the millions who had migrated to the cities from farms and small towns, many did not return. America was now a more urban, industrial society.
Society became much larger, much more impersonal. The mom and pop store, which my mother had, no longer could compete with these supermarkets and the big chains that moved in. People began to go outside the neighborhood. It changed the lifestyle to a great extent. By 1946, the grocery store was gone.
The war years took people away from their familiar patterns, away from their friends, away from their families, away from their church, away from their place of work. And when the war was over, they didn't all go right back to those same places.
The war has also brought changes that many Americans fear and mistrust. Although many women lost their jobs at war's end, many others remained in the workforce. By 1946, there are 5 million more women employed than before the war, and their numbers are steadily growing.
I felt that the women had a place in the world, and I was part of it, and that I was never going ever to go back to being what I had been. I could never go back to playing bridge, being a club woman, listening to a lot of inanities when there were things that you could use your mind for.
A few years before that, I would have been afraid with a small child to have ever struck out on my own. But by this time, I knew that I could make a living. And I knew that I did not need anyone to make a living for me. But the reason that I knew it is because I had done it already. I had been there.
As with women, the wartime progress of black Americans will not disappear with the coming of peace. The fight for racial equality has turned into something large and powerful on the American scene. The modern civil rights movement has begun.
As black people began to experience some of the niceties of life, You could see that the natives were going to get restless. They would never be satisfied with the way they had lived before, and the expectations began to change. They began to expect more.
For many Americans, the memories of the Second World War will remain as the most vivid in their lives. For each, the meaning is unique and personal.
When the war was finally over and we got our orders to go home, at long last, we were all very excited and eager to get home. But before we went home, they had to have one more parade. And we all had to get into our uniforms and line up for a dismissal and separation from service parade. When it was over, we all threw our hats up in the air and screamed and yelled and cheered because we didn't want to do that ever again. And I recall very well one of the captains standing and looking at us without cheering, and he's saying, "You don't understand how big a part of your life this has been. And when you hear a marching band sometime in the future, you'll pick up the beat, and you'll be back right here on the parade ground marching again." And he was right. That's the way it's turned out.
The Gold Star Mothers have a bond. We are a unique organization because we have lost our dear ones for our country's sake.
You felt that you knew what it was to die and to have to go somewhere where you couldn't take anything but what you had inside of you. And so that it strengthened you. I think that from then on we were very strong. I don't think anything could get us down now. We could go through anything.
I think that the war changed all of us, particularly probably those in my age group. After the war was over with, I wanted to block it out. I didn't want to see war movies. I didn't want to read books about the war. I felt that it was just something I wanted to put behind me and forget about it the best that I could and try to get back to having a normal family life. That was my main concern.
Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. For that's the night that my baby and I used to dance cheek to cheek. I don't mind Sunday nights at all, for that's the night friends come to call. And Monday through Friday go fast, and another week is past.
I'll never smile again until I smile at you. I'll never love again. What good would it do? The tears will fill my eyes. My heart will realize our romance was through. We had lots of romances in Boeing. Lots of girls met lots of boys.
Drinking beer in a cabaret, and was I having fun? Until one night shot out the light. Now we're on the run. Oh, lay that pistol down, babe. Lay that pistol down. Pistol packing mama. Lay that pistol down. That's a song we used to sing. Every time the fellows came home, we'd gather around the piano, and songs like that came out.
Praise the Lord and pass the ammunition. Praise the Lord and pass the ammunition. Praise the Lord and pass the ammunition, and we'll all stay free.